Hello, I am Slimer Dude, also known as Steve Eynon, and welcome to my 15-minute talk entitled Fantom, the Developer's Choice. So, what is Fantom? Well, Fantom is a future-proof next-generation language. Now, that's a bold statement, so let's look at some examples of why I think this to be true. But to do so, we'll have to compare Fantom against a normal, current-generation language. And for that, we're going to use Java. Now, I've picked Java because it's a popular language many will be familiar with. But who am I to be making this comparison? Well, I am Steve Eynon, and I would call myself a full-stack web application developer. I have a lot of experience with languages such as Assembler, Visual Basic, Java, JavaScript, Ruby, C#, and of course, Fantom. Now, Java in particular, I've used for most of my career. And in fact, I have over 13 continuous years of Java development. But given an option, I wouldn't use most of these languages. Why? Well, not that I particularly dislike them, but I do consider them to be tedious, limited, complicated, anti-agile, and some just downright plain ugly, which leaves Fantom. Now, for this presentation, we're going to do a countdown of the topics of literals, the core API, concurrency, language sugar, and cross-platform development. And note it is a programmer's countdown because it is zero-based. From the top, number 4. Literals. Fantom is a forward-thinking language. Let's see how. Now, in Java, if you want to represent a number, you have a crazy amount of choices. Bytes, shorts, characters, ints, longs, and then choose your number of bits, be it 18, 16, 32, or 64. And in C#, you even have signed and unsigned choices. Like, whoa, I don't care, I have a number. Let's say it's 10. Perhaps I'll change it to 2,000. Maybe 200,000. I don't know. I don't want to pre-calculate the min-max range. The thing is, all of this unwanted choice is to deal with legacy architectures from a time when it wasn't efficient to perform 64-bit addition. And that inefficiency was mocked by C and assembler developers, even if it didn't matter in the grand scheme of the program. More to the point, in today's world of 64-bit architecture supremacy, it isn't even more efficient to process smaller bit numbers. Some even argue it takes longer because of extra masking that may be involved. So what of Fantom then? Well, it has one int, and it is 64 bits. Job done. Now, would you ever need more bits? Realistically, and for general purpose numbers, I would say probably not, because 64 bits is pretty darn huge. I mean, Fantom stores time as an int. It represents nanoseconds since the year 2000, and that gives us plus or minus, you know, 300 years at a pretty high precision. High precision, yes, because 1 milliseconds is equal to 1 million nanoseconds. Now, when it comes to literals, that is, types understood by the compiler, most languages only recognize numbers, booleans, and strings. So let's talk about a pet hate of mine. Now, what is wrong with this code? Well, it is going to print, "This spaceship will self-destruct in 10. 10? 10 what? 10 seconds? 10 hours? What? Damn it, units are important, especially if my spaceship is about to explode. But more realistically, I see this a lot in APIs when setting timeouts, and it leaves the developer guessing as to whether to pass in minutes, seconds, or milliseconds. Get it wrong, and your 1 second timeout may turn into 16.5 minutes. So, Fantom introduces a handy duration literal, meaning that if you add the word sec or min to a number, then the Fantom compiler doesn't create an instance of a number. Instead, it creates an instance of a duration class. Now I know exactly when my spaceship will explode, which is good news for some. Now Fantom doesn't stop there. It also has a URI literal. Use backticks instead of normal quotes to create an instance of a URI class. It may seem strange at first, but think about it. We're in the age of the Internet of Things. And it's not just web pages that have URLs anymore, there are images, sounds, REST APIs, databases, and even local file systems. But it's not just URLs, the Fantom literal is a URI, that is Universal Resource Indicator, meaning much like how XML is to HTML, you can use it to create your own schemes and IDs. I mean, Why use simple numbers or strings as database IDs when you could be using recognizable and hierarchical URIs? For example, why use the obscure number 36 when you could use a URI that comes complete with useful metadata such as what application it belongs to and what collection it represents? On to number 3. Fantom's concise and sane API is a developer's dream. That's nice, but let's first look at what's not a developer's dream. The Java Collections Framework. Say you want a simple list of objects in Java. Arrays are fixed and too inflexible, so you opt for a list object. But do you want a collection, a set, sorted set, a list, a queue, a deck? And that's just the interfaces. From there you have to choose an implementation. Is it array-based, linked, hashed, trees? Man, the mind boggles. In all, there are about 45 classes and interfaces just for lists and maps in Java. If you think all this is okay, then have a look at this. The Java Ultimate website presents this simple view of a list. Boy, I'd hate to see the complicated view. Look, I just want an ordered list of, say, 10 things. I really shouldn't need a computer science degree to choose the right implementation. So, by comparison, let's see what Fantom has to offer. A list. It handles generics. It has functional methods with closures and all the methods you would ever need. Especially for a newcomer to Fantom, or programming in general, this list is easy to remember and easy to use. Job done. Another Java example, this time with streams. The Java I/O package has some 80 classes, and Fantom has two, an in-stream and an out-stream. Again, they're functional, use closures, and have all the methods you need. Easy to remember, easy to use. Now let's put some of these 80 Java classes to work and read a plain text file. Now this is the accepted answer from a Stack Overflow question on how to read a plain text file in Java. It's 14 lines long. Man, how complicated is that? So let's look at Fantom. One line. File.readAllString. It's that simple. And this is not just some handy utility method, this is the core API, and it is just one small example of the thought gone into making common tasks really simple. Note how we use a URI to represent a file on the file system. On the subject of text files, what of character sets and text encoding? The great Joel Spolsky once said, there is no such thing as plain text. But let's face it, UTF-8 comes pretty close. And thankfully, Fantom defaults to UTF-8 for everything text-related, and hence truly becomes platform-independent. Note that Java gets character sets very wrong and uses a platform default, meaning that unless you're very, very careful, you end up with incompatible text files on different systems. Even the Maven bool tool fell foul of this one. 2. Concurrency. Fantom uses actors and the message processing model. Now this is quite a technical topic that really deserves its own presentation to do its justice. But it is also too important not to mention, so we'll just skim over some of the main points. First, we'll look at Java's stance on concurrency. It uses mutable state. Mutable state is simple enough to understand. Each thread has access to the same bit of data, and each thread may update it at any time. Unfortunately, Java tries to be clever and introduces things like thread data caching. And what happens when you need to update two bits of data at the same time and you don't want any of the thread to access it until you've finished? Kind of like the contrived example of crediting one bank account and debiting the other. All this and more means you need to be an expert in multiple concurrency models just to implement the basics. In brief, mutable state in Java is difficult to implement safely, because to do it properly, you also need to fully understand threads, locks, semaphores, JSR133, and broken double locking mechanisms, and more. Now, functional programming says that all state is evil. If that's true, then surely mutable state must be the ultimate evil. Now, Java has 60 classes dedicated to doing concurrency properly. Given all the complications of the above, then implementing mutable state safely is also prone to errors and mistakes. And it's not even scalable. If you wanted more processing threads, then you're just creating a bottleneck on the synchronized data. By comparison, Fantom employs an actor framework and the message processing model. Here, threads, also known as actors, send messages to each other. These messages are just instances of Fantom classes, but not just any classes, immutable classes. This means the message content cannot change, hence we don't have the mutable state conundrum that Java has. Better yet, it's not even possible to compile a Fantom program whereby different threads have access to the same bit of data. Therefore, when it comes to concurrency, Fantom as a language is inherently safe. Actors are easy to understand and implement. It only takes four classes in the Fantom concurrent pod. And the compiler forces the use of immutable message classes between actors, which makes it safer and less prone to errors. And the actor model is also scalable, allowing you to add more threaded workers as you wish. Number 1. Language Sugar. Fantom's language sugar makes it a joy to program. There are so many little things to mention here, I found it difficult to limit myself, but I've picked three to share with you today. Now, Java has fields. But if you wanted to alter the behaviour slightly, like trimming and validating inputs, then you would need a method, and then you'd need to change all your code from using the field to using the method. And this is painful. And Java programmers usually forgo fields altogether, and instead create lots of boilerplate getter and setter methods. It's tedious. Fantom, on the other hand, has real field accessors, something I've missed since my early days of programming Visual Basic. Not even C# properties come close to the real power of Fantom fields. Here, we have examples of three Fantom fields. The first is a standard public Fantom field. The second has a getter and a setter. Note that these are optional, and any field may or may not have them. It doesn't matter if they exist or not, all the code that uses that field stays the same. Even better, if you want to make the field read-only, just make the setter private. No boilerplate code, no getter and setter methods, just intelligent fields. Next, a quick look at the Java syntax. Here, we create a new string builder class, and we assign it to a string builder variable. Note how we've just had to type string builder twice. And this happens a lot in Java. It's strongly typed, and we have to repeat ourselves over and over and over, which makes for really long lines of code, especially when you start adding in generics. Now, Fantom is different. It uses type inference to determine what the variables should be. Here we create a string buff, similar to Java's string builder, but Fantom knows what it is and hence assigns it automatically to a string buff variable. We don't repeat ourselves and it cuts down a lot of code. Now, other languages have cottoned on to the concise expressiveness of type inference, but Fantom gives real power to the programmer and goes one step further. It has a unique loose type inference, whereby if something could work, then it assumes it does work. A quick example to explain it. Assume we have a method eat that takes a cat. Now, the compiler will balk if we try to pass in a dog, but it will let us pass in an animal instance, even if it's wrong. That will, of course, cause a runtime error. But in the course of static programming, 99.9% of the time, we know what our variables are, and in practice, this is never an issue. But what it does do for us is dramatically cut down the amount of casting and type coercion, meaning we type a heck of a lot less. Fantom code visibility. This is such a small thing, but it means so much to me because I write so many libraries and pods for Fantom. Now, Fantom has three main visibility types. It has private visibility, which means it is private to the class. And it has public visibility, which means everyone can see it. This is the public API that your library exposes to the outside world. And then there's internal visibility. That means it is only accessible to the containing pod or library. This is brilliant, because it means you can now pick and choose what to share with the outside world and keep all your internals hidden from view. For example, the Sizzle pod, which performs CSS letters on XML documents, it has a tiny public API of one class and six methods, but internally it has 10 classes and countless methods. A common problem in other languages like Java is that they expose everything, which makes it very daunting for users to know which classes and methods they should be using. Other cool language sugar that I could mention include default method parameters, everything is an object, nullable types, dynamic programming, and so on. In fact, there are just too many to mention. And finally, we've reached the end of the countdown. Down to zero, Fantom for cross-platform development. Fantom runs great on a Java JVM, and there's a lot of work gone into a .NET implementation also. But annotate any class with @js and it automatically gets compiled to JavaScript. That's right, the entire Fantom runtime and system pod is available in JavaScript and runs in a browser. If you want to specifically write Fantom that targets the browser environment, then the DOM and the DOMKit libraries give you some kick-ass performance. But better yet, the core Fantom graphics library and the windowing toolkit, written initially for desktops, also run in a browser. Man, I can't tell you how cool this is. In fact, I can only show you. So here is a little game I created. I wrote it in Fantom, and I wrote the entire game to run as a desktop application. I then set about making it run in a browser. To do that, for the entire game, took just 25 minutes, including creating a website to serve it from. It's called Fanny the Fantom, features some retro-looking vector graphics, and even persists its high scores to a server on the internet. If you would like to play with my Fanny, or read about Fantom, then check out these websites. Please do get in touch if you have any queries regarding Fanny, Fantom, or programming in general. I am Steve Eynon, and this has been why I consider Fantom to be the developer's choice.